If you've been watching the headlines this week, then you have seen that there is an incredible amount of cyber hacking happening all over the United States, targeting not only everyday Americans like you and me, but even the presidential candidates for the US election in 2024. The most significant piece of news that I'm talking about is the massive Social Security number data breach that was recently reported by the data broker data aggregator known as National Public Data. Now, National Public Data is a background check and investigative company based out of Florida that's responsible for doing background and security checks on Americans who are applying for jobs. Whether it's a government job or a corporate job or even just a background check for a loan, their job is to aggregate all of the data about you and me and every other American so that they can create a security profile that they can pass forward to their client. Now that gives them a certain status known as third-party information broker. It means that they can collect data and then that data is rented or purchased by someone else. The problem with that is that that makes it so that your data and my data are only as safe, only as secure as the third party's security system. And in this case, we're finding out that National Public Data's information security was not the best. Not only were they recently hacked in August of this year, but they actually reported a hack back in April of this year as well. Now, since we're talking about data breaches and data hacks, let's not forget that in April of 2024, AT&T reported the largest hack that they had ever seen, a hack that actually pulled almost 277 gigabytes worth of user data from every AT&T user that had ever existed. So that means that in April of this year, not only did we have AT&T get hacked, but we had National Public Data get hacked. Let's keep this train going because Google and Microsoft also reported very active hacking efforts, specifically by the Iranians, targeting their Microsoft and Google email system. So if you use Outlook or if you use Gmail, that means the Iranians are actively trying to get onto your email servers. Why? Because they know that the Trump and Harris campaigns are using Microsoft and Google accounts in order to communicate with their consultants, their campaign managers, and their sponsors. So what we're seeing here is a very concerted effort, not only by foreign intelligence, but also by professional hacking groups to hack into databases that they know are third-party providers of information storage or information aggregation. That's known as an information broker. And this hacking effort isn't only targeting Americans, it's actually also targeting UK citizens and Canadian citizens also. So with 277 gigabytes of private American data available on the dark web, and more than 2.9 billion users compromised globally to foreign intelligence and cyber hacking groups, the question becomes, what can you do to protect your digital private online information? Now in the wake of this compromise, and because we have to anticipate that more compromises are coming and more efforts are coming down the road, my goal today is to give you three spy hacks you can use to protect your personal data online in the wake of this compromise, as well as protect the private online data of your children, your spouse, your extended family, even your close friends. My name is Andrew Bustamante, and I am a former CIA intelligence officer, and I use a very specific software to protect the cybersecurity health of myself and my family. And that same software is the first solution that I want to present to you as a spy hack for your own use. Now, the service I use is called Aura, and Aura is actually a formal sponsor for this video. Now, I understand that a lot of people have strong opinions whenever a company comes in and sponsors a video on YouTube. I don't really care about your strong opinions. What I care about is communicating the effectiveness of the service that I use and giving you an option to use the same service. Now, here's what Aura does for me. Recall that we were just talking about how the recent security breaches are targeting what's known as third-party data brokers or data aggregators. What that means is that these companies can collect your data and then sell your data to other companies, essentially being a broker for sales of your information. Now, one of the primary services that Aura provides is that it actually creates an automated function that constantly requests that your personal data be deleted from the archives of these data aggregation companies. By law, data brokers have to delete your personal information anytime they receive a message on your behalf asking that your data be deleted. So what Aura does is it has a constant running algorithm that goes out to more than 300 different data brokers asking that your data be constantly deleted from their accounts at any given time. Now, why is that important? Because a data aggregator is constantly refreshing its data. So if you request a deletion on Monday, they might delete it on Tuesday, but then on Wednesday, their crawlers go back out and pull your data again, and they can retain your data again by law. So it's important to have a service that works on your behalf have to go through and actually request constantly the deletion of your personal data off these data broker records. Now, in addition to scrubbing and cleaning your data off of the open internet, Aura also does the same thing to monitor your presence on the dark web and advise you through their dashboard anytime your data is appearing on the dark web. On top of that, they give you a VPN service, they give you a secure password manager, they give you the ability to monitor your bank accounts and your credit score in real time, and they give you $1 million in identity theft insurance. Not only do these tools give me an incredible amount of peace of mind, but they give me an awesome amount of control over my own personal online data, especially in the wake of what we've seen happen with Microsoft and Gmail, as well as the hacks that we've seen successfully occur against AT&T, and now this most recent breach from National Public Data. Don't take my word for it. Go out and try Aura for yourself. Go to aura.com/everydayspy, and you'll get a complimentary 2-week trial offer to try this software out for yourself. Explore the dashboard, see the password manager, try the VPN, look at your own dark web footprint, submit your own request to data brokers to have your data deleted. Try it out for yourself, and you'll see that Aura will quickly become one of the most trusted tools you have on your mobile phone, on your laptop, and literally in your pocket every day, just like I do. Spy hack number 2. Now, you already know that passwords are one of the primary tools that you use to protect your data, and passwords are also one of the primary things that are compromised so that big hacking groups and foreign intelligence services can get onto mainstream company servers. So that means that protecting your data is just as much about protecting your password. But here's the thing. In order to protect your password, yes, you need some sort of password protection service like we just talked about with Aura. But what you can also use is something known as a passphrase. Now, there's a difference between a password and a passphrase. Consider your typical spy TV show or spy movie where someone breaks onto a server or breaks onto a computer using a password, right? They type in a birthday, or they type in a family name, or they type in a pet name, Twinkle112. When you think of a password, don't think of it in terms of a word, but think of it in terms of a number of spaces that are used to create an alphanumeric code that's difficult to crack. So whether you're typing in hello or whether you're typing in 02125, it really doesn't matter through the lens of a computer because the number of spaces is the same. So what that means is that a relatively unsophisticated computer can hack a password that gets up to about 12 characters. So that's why you see so often that software systems and online services are asking you to create a password that's longer than 12 or 14 characters. Because the more characters you have, the more complicated it is to crack. This is where the magic of a passphrase kicks in. Because it's very difficult to remember a word that takes up 12 characters. It's even hard to create an alphanumeric word that takes up letters and numbers that's 12 characters. But we all have a tendency to remember phrases much easier. For example, I love my wife. That is a phrase that's easy to remember. And if we put a year on that, something like the year we got married, I love my wife 2011. Actually, we got married in 2010. I hope my wife doesn't watch this video. But I love my wife 2010, that is 15 letter characters plus 4 space characters for a total of 19 total alphanumeric characters that would have to be cracked in order for someone to break into that account. That is an example of a passphrase. But you can make that passphrase anything that's important to you, anything that's easy for you to remember. So maybe it's about your college mascot. Maybe it's about your first girlfriend. Maybe it's about your favorite TV show. Whatever you want it to be, you can make that your passphrase. Live long and prosper. I don't know what I'm doing. I hate computers. Eat this, you fucking hackers. Whatever you want it to be, you can make that your passphrase. And simply by adding characters to the end, it makes it even more difficult to crack. That is a powerful spy hack that we use at CIA every day to protect our accounts. Spy hack number 3. You've all heard and seen reminders to turn on what's known as two-factor authentication. But here's the truth. Two-factor authentication is kind of a pain in the ass. Not only that, but it can be a little bit tricky to set up on the cyber side, whether you're tracking people back to an authentication app, or whether you're sending people to a cell phone number, or whether you're sending people to an email address. But one of the most reliable and secure systems out there for protecting your personal data still remains two-factor authentication. So if you've been ignoring those requests from your bank or from your social media app or from your online internet provider to create a two-factor authentication, now is the perfect time to stop ignoring them and start taking advantage of it. What I find is the most useful form of two-factor authentication is to actually have the 2FA set up to go to a text message on your phone. Yes, you can send it to email addresses. Yes, you can send it to authentication apps. apps, but by far the most reliable and convenient that I have found is to have it go directly to your cell phone. And there's two reasons why. First, if it goes directly to your cell phone, you pretty much always have your cell phone around. So it's very easy to give yourself your own two-factor authentication. So if you're logging on from somebody else's computer, or if you're logging on from a new phone, but you still have your old phone, or even if you're giving your permission to get on your account to somebody else in your family, or maybe a family attorney, it's easy to just click yes on the 2FA using your cell phone. It's much more difficult if it's going to an email, because you don't always get notified by that email, or that email sometimes ends up in a spam folder, and it's much easier than using some sort of online app, because the app needs a refresh time. So set up two-factor authentication to your phone to go directly to a text message. The second reason that's so useful is because if you get a request for 2FA from your cell phone and you're not expecting it, that's how you know that there's an attempted hack happening against your account. So from there, you can start taking remedial actions to explore what's going on in your account, who might have access to your account, and when the hack was attempted. So there's multiple reasons why I prefer having two-factor authentication go via text message to my cell phone, and I would encourage the same to you. Now, if you're still with me, we've gone through three awesome spy hacks to protect your personal information online. We went through a service known as Aura. We then talked about passphrases instead of passwords, and we just talked about two-factor authentication. Now, let me give you a special bonus fourth option that you're gonna see circulated online, but I don't recommend, and that's called an account or credit freeze, which means reaching out to one of the big three credit monitoring services and freezing their ability to start a new line of credit. I don't disagree that this is an effective way to protect your data, but what needs to also be said is that this is going to cause a great deal of inconvenience to you personally, because once you put that freeze in place, you have to go back and remove that freeze later if you plan on submitting requests for a loan, getting a new credit card, or even opening a new bank account. Nobody wants to freeze their account today out of fear and then forget about it in 3 months and wonder why they're being rejected for a new loan or a new credit card, especially not when you have easier solutions that are out there. The reason that you're seeing so much conversation about freezing your credit and freezing your credit lines is because it is a very strong and very secure solution. And the very same companies that got hacked have to give you some kind of answer, some kind of guidance, or some kind of solution. So AT&T and National Public Data are both telling you and telling the world that all you need to protect yourself is a credit freeze. And oh, by the way, that credit freeze is very simple to execute, which it's not, by going to these three credit monitoring services and requesting a freeze. So not only is it kind of convoluted and complicated, but after you execute the freeze, it's also convoluted and complicated to get the freeze lifted off of your accounts. That's why I am not recommending you go down that road. It is a tool that you can use, especially if you want to go ahead and be extra cautious and extra safe. But I would recommend first that you follow the three spy hacks that I gave you. Sign up for Aura at aura.com/everydayspy. That is your best solution. That is an all-in-one solution to keep yourself safe now and in the future. You can get a 2-week free trial if you go to aura.com/everydayspy, or if you just click in the top link in the description below. You can also use passphrases instead of passwords. Passphrases are a much more secure option than passwords. They're very easy to remember, and you can literally update them in just a few seconds to protect your online information. And third, you can turn on your two-factor authentication. Yes, it can be complicated. Yes, it can be a little bit of a pain in the ass, especially for folks who are not as comfortable with technology yet. But especially if you're one of those people that isn't comfortable with technology, just set up two-factor authentication so it sends a text message to your cell phone, and you're going to be resting much easier when you go to bed tonight than you were when you heard this video in the morning. We are living in unprecedented times right now, with more cyber attacks and more cyber threats than ever before. Not only are they targeting you and I as everyday people, but they're targeting presidents, former presidents, presidential campaigns, big businesses, and major international conglomerates. And with this increase in cyber aggression, we have to increase our efforts to protect ourselves. We can't rely on companies to do it for us. We can't rely on the government to do it for us. We have to take that responsibility and that action in our own hands. And that's why I wanted to give you these three powerful spy hacks to protect your data online. If you want to find a way to bring more spy skills like this into your everyday life to protect yourself, your business, and your family, go ahead and visit the links in the description below so that you can learn how to see the world through the eyes of a spy. It's been great to talk to you today. I'm excited to see you apply these three spy skills into your everyday life, and I will see you next time.